Welcome to another Wisdom Pod with Peter Rojas. Peter is Director of Product Management at Meta. It's a round two. Peter's an interesting guy, to say the least. Former VC, former founder, and editor-in-chief at Engadget, and a bunch of interesting startups. Gizmodo, if you know the magazine, that's also him. Cool guy altogether, and I just love have him on and discuss about the wide array of topics, what's happening in the world, especially around technology and everything in between. This pod is presented to you by podbar.com. If you want to start your own podcast, you can go to podbar.com. We do it the unconventional way and help you scale through monetization, shady methods that will get you a bunch of leads, but will also grow your brain, grow your network, and everything in between. Peter, welcome to the pod again. Tell me a bit more about yourself again, re-intro, and tell me about what you're up to nowadays.
Yeah, thanks for having me back on. I enjoyed the conversation last time around. So as you mentioned, I'm a director of product management here at Meta, currently on the product leadership team at Messenger. So if you've ever used our Messenger app or Messenger within Facebook or Instagram Direct, that's something that is within the Messenger product org, and stuff that I've worked on over the past 6 months or so after I joined. Previously had been head of product for Meta's new product experimentation organization, where we were building and shipping entirely new standalone products for the company. Unfortunately, you know, given the challenges of the past couple of years, we made a decision to sunset NPE, and so wasn't able to continue working on that, which is obviously a little heartbreaking. I joined Meta to work specifically on that. And, you know, I'm excited about a lot of the stuff I'm doing right now at Messenger. You know, of course, you know, have to mention that I'm not appearing on the podcast as a representative of Meta or in my official capacity or anything like that, as you know. You know, it's, you know, really excited to like be, you know, hands-on and building stuff again. As you mentioned previously, I've been a VC of BetaWorks Ventures. Some of the biggest investments that I have worked on there were Rec Room, one of the leaders in social gaming, and then Hugging Face, the number one open source AI company out there, which just announced a big partnership with Google, which I'm pretty excited about. And then previously been a four-time startup founder, helped start Gizmodo and Gawker Media, Engadget, Joystick, and Weblogs Inc., and did a music startup and then a social commerce company, and had two acquisitions from the four.
Gawker, I didn't know that was you. I followed.
Yeah, Gizmodo actually predated Gawker, because as the Gawker website. So Nick and I started Gizmodo a bit as an experiment, and it went better than expected. And so he really wanted to, you know, turn it into like a bigger, you know, blogging business. And so the next site that was launched was Gawker, Gawker.com, and then they ended up using that as the name for the company rather than Gizmodo Media. I wanted to call it Gawker Media, and kind of went from there.
I studied Nick after the book of Ryan Holiday with the coup organized by Thiel. You weren't a victim of Thiel. You were just like in the stand, sort of.
Yeah, I had left. I left in 2004 to do Weblogs Inc. with Jason Calacanis at that point and Brian Alvey. And so it didn't really impact me, except that, like, obviously I care a lot about, you know, anything that I've started, and you know, that Gizmodo is still around and thriving is something that makes me really happy. It's actually doing quite well. I, you know, I was definitely, you know, someone who, you know, I grew up in the 80s watching Hulk Hogan, you know, and wrestling on TV and things like that. And so the idea that somehow he would bankrupt something that I started was, you know, just hard to process. It was just very surreal. And I wasn't negatively impacted at all by what happened there.
Right. I spoke with one of Thiel's lieutenant 2 or 3 days ago, and apparently Thiel's a pretty nice guy, you know, when you personally know him. But I think Nick really got under his skin there, and Thiel viewed this as a grandmaster chess match or something, and it was perfectly executed. What is your take on freedom of speech? You know, like, where does it stop covering the news and gossip in the Silicon Valley? Where should that stop? Should we encourage, you know, like just sharing everything in people's private lives? Or at some point, should we be like, okay, yeah, this is a bit too much?
Yeah. Well, okay. So I'll just, again, caveat my answer by saying, you know, I work at Meta. You know, we have obviously like the biggest platforms in the world for people to be able to share and communicate with one another and connect with one another. You know, I am not involved on the policy or privacy or any of that side of things. Obviously, I do have connections to it. And so, you know, again, I'm not speaking in any official capacity, or this is just my personal opinion on this stuff. You know, I will say, you know, I think it's really helpful to, because I think it's a big question, right? Like, you know, talk about freedom of speech, right? I think it's really important to distinguish between, you know, what the government limits and what private companies limit, right? And I think that just at a basic level, I think, you know, private individuals and private, you know, organizations or companies, I think they have a right of association, right? Which is part of their freedom of speech, right? You know, Elon Musk isn't compelled to let anyone post to Twitter, right? You know, that's his right, you know, as the owner to decide who publishes, you know, who publishes there and who doesn't. Just in the same way that, like, you know, you could say even I don't have the right, or, you know, just in the same way that, like, I don't have the right to maybe publish Twitter, like, I also don't have the right to publish from his Twitter account, you know, for example. So I think we recognize that there are differences and limitations and, you know, what we're talking about here, right? And I think it's, I think at a base level, it's always important to recognize that freedom of speech has, you know, an individual right, you know, from a governmental standpoint, and then individuals have a right in terms of, you know, you're not obligated to share, distribute, support, you know, anybody else's speech, right? You know, having been a journalist, it was really important for me that the internet was a space where people were able to, you know, post and share things that they cared about and were important to them. I think when I was started off doing Gizmodo and Engadget, you know, I got a lot of flack from companies that I covered because I would, you know, I would publish, you know, unannounced information. I would, you know, leak things. And the way I always looked at it was, I said, I'm never going to break the law in terms of, you know, how I obtain this information, right? And you can't, there's trade secrets law in the US. I don't know as much about it in other places. But you can't pay someone to violate a confidentiality agreement, you know, which makes sense, right? You can't induce someone to, you know, to give you information that they are, you know, that they have signed an agreement to hold confidential, right? But if someone gives you the information for other reasons, like, you can work with that, right? And so, you know, I think something that maybe people didn't realize is how much, one, companies themselves were leaking information to build buzz around their announcements. And in the early days of blogging, they didn't really get it. But by like 2005, 2006, and definitely like 2007, 2008, they really, like, you know, most leaks were planted at that point. I think they also started to come around and realize that there was enthusiasm about their products, and that, you know, you can try to contain it or you can try to work with it. And so I think there was that. But I always really valued, like, my freedom as a journalist, right, who published his own site that he owned, to make my own decisions about what I wanted to share and what I didn't want to share. I also took very seriously my reputation for being accurate. Wasn't always accurate, but tried to be accurate as possible. But also that to be honest and straightforward with readers about what, you know, what I knew and what I didn't know. I think that, like, you know, there's a broader societal question which we're facing right now. And I think AI comes into this also, right? Around misinformation, deep fakes, manipulation. And I think that right now we have more questions than answers about what are the limits there. And the thing that, like, I think that I wish we could have is have a conversation, you know, and a debate. A healthy society could have a healthy debate about what policies do we want to have? What limits do we want to place? Because if you think about every right that we have, it is always balanced against the potential harm that it can create, you know, whatever that right is. There's no unlimited right to anything, because there's always some societal harm, right, that we balance against. And so to me, the question isn't freedom of speech, no freedom of speech. It's where do we want to draw the line on this stuff? When it comes to AI, for example, where do we want to draw the line around what is a permissible use of for training data? What is a permissible use for, you know, if you're manipulating content, you know, do we want that labeled? And the reality is, you know, if you want to manipulate words or images or videos, people have been doing that for a long time. It just gets easier now, you know?
Right.
And I think in Europe, I think that like maybe in France that you have to, magazines have to label if the ads have been, if the models have been Photoshopped or something like that.
I like that.
Yeah, it's an interesting, right? It's sort of saying, hey, you know, you should just be transparent about it. And I think there was something saying if a bot should always have to tell you that they're a bot, you know, which is kind of interesting.
Like I like that too.
Yeah, like maybe we just say, hey, you know, and if you, it's, you know, I think a good example is email marketing. You're too young, but I remember before the CAN Spam Act was enacted. And spam was, people thought in like 2000, like email's done. Like spam has ruined it. We're never going to figure it out. We're never going to fix it. And then two things happened, right? One is the spam filters got better because of machine learning. And the other is that Congress passed the legislation, which said, if you're going to send people marketing messages, here are some rules about it. And you have to, if they, and you have to put an unsubscribe link and you have to honor that link. That's the balance, what we say, right? Like being able to email somebody, is that a form of free speech? Sure, but it's, you know, but we put a limit on it to balance the harm because otherwise then nobody can use it, use email, right? And so I think that's a rare example of legislation which worked. And the fact that people are able to build email subscription newsletter businesses now, that people are able to do email new marketing is all because we place limits to prevent bad actors from spoiling it for everybody else. So I'm in favor of doing smart things. You know, it's just hard because it's hard to get consensus on this stuff now and everybody gets, you know, politicized and nobody wants to give up ground to the other side. But I still am optimistic that we can figure these things out.
Yeah. Well, Google is tightening its deliverability rules again in 6 days from now. Yahoo too, but who cares about Yahoo? You know, like Gmail, I think it's 20% of email users, especially in prominent countries. So yeah, they're tightening it again. And yeah, I think AI is the response to that. I've had Andy Mowat on the pod. He's in SF and he started Gated, which is like, hey, you receive this email, you reply automatically to the person. It's like, hey, donate $20 to my favorite cause and this email will get in, you know? And he closed his business last year that didn't work, didn't get product market fit. So do believe in AI. Now, coming back to the Thiel case, it's very interesting, right? Because I think he made himself, he painted the target on his back, you know, because you cannot overrun all the journalists, you know, that's one. I think when you become famous, there's a price to pay, right? Like you need to assume that people are going to want to look at your life and so forth. But the question is like, yeah, when your life becomes unlivable, do you go outside and you have paparazzi on you and people harassing you? And then your income becomes limited by a piece that a journalist put forward. A good case would be Sam Bankman-Fried. I don't think he's been proven guilty yet, but
everyone... No, he was proven guilty.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Pre-trial... He's in prison now. Yeah, so. Okay. But pre-trial, everyone, you know, the press was against him, and maybe that influenced the trial. But anyway, I'm not pleading that he's not guilty, but I think when you, like, vice grip someone's life and limit someone's income, like people no longer want to invest in that person, people no longer want to buy their products, then we might have a problem. Or is it the cost of being successful and famous and rich?
I mean, I think this is one of those things where, again, I think that we haven't like caught up to the changes, because it was this stuff around who counted as a public figure was much easier before the internet, right? Because, you know, the threshold of getting, I remember when I was a kid, I'm almost 50, right? So I remember when I was a kid, if someone was on TV, that was like the biggest deal. Like you couldn't even imagine, like being like, oh, I met someone who was on TV. That was like the biggest thing you can imagine. Being on TV yourself was unimaginable, right? Like, just like you couldn't even like process something like that, right? And now that I've been on TV, I'm just like, oh, whatever, it doesn't matter, you know. It's kind of, it's like not a big deal, especially now, because nobody cares. But it's so I think that like what we haven't navigated is, you know, what is the threshold for somebody counting as a public figure now? And I'll give an example, like, you know, ValleyWag, which was, you know, the site that posted
the ancestor stuff, you know, of Gawker.
Well, it was the tech version of Gawker, which Gawker Media had. They went out, like, they posted nasty stuff about me. You know, after my first child was born, they published my home address and pictures of my kid.
That's nasty.
Yeah, it was nasty. And it really upset my wife, you know, upset me too. You know, I didn't think about like taking legal action. I just thought that like morally it was wrong. Right. And I think that like, you know, for me, it's funny because one of the reasons I left Gawker Media, left Gizmodo, was that Nick and I had a disagreement about whether or not to go after people personally, right? And I felt like, look, I'm not interested in people's kids or their personal lives, or, you know, I mean, maybe from like a you know, obviously like gossip is always sort of interesting, but I was like, that's not what I want to cover. Like, I want to talk about like tech and what I'm excited about. And, you know, I think that he, you know, he had a different perspective than me. And so, you know, for me, set aside legal, right? I just felt like morally, you know, I think it's tougher to figure out like, where do you draw the line about like, when is someone a public figure and when they're not? I think that now I would say Thiel is a difficult case, right? In a way, because, you know, he is very conservative and supporting a lot of conservative causes, which are, you know, anti-LGBT, you know, Q, what, you know, and he himself was not publicly out about his orientation, right? Now, on one hand, you're like, well, someone has a right to privacy there. It's their personal life. They shouldn't have to like discuss things that are about themselves. Nick's perspective was, I don't really care whether he's gay or not. Nick himself is gay. I don't know if that's how well known that is, but, yeah, and also conservative. Well, yeah. And also very conservative. In fact, Nick and Peter are very similar, to be honest, which is kind of weird. I think I think Nick's perspective was, and I wasn't there at the time and never had a conversation with directly, but just knowing how he approached these things would be, you know, you can't be gay privately and then be hurting gay people publicly, so to speak, in terms of the causes and politics you support. And Nick hated hypocrisy above all else. Now, I think that he used hypocrisy as a way to justify him being an asshole to people, you know, in a way that I wasn't comfortable with. And so I left, right? I voted with my feet and said, I don't want to be a part of this anymore. You know, but for me, I always felt like, you know, erring on the side of trying to be as ethical and moral as possible. And, you know, I had no problem calling out companies, you know, I had no problem calling out or bad behavior, professional bad behavior, so to speak. But I don't know. It just like, it seemed to me like going after people's kids or their personal lives or things like that. Like, and again, it was very, you know, not appropriate to me.
Yeah. It's always nuance and
yeah, it's tough.
This is that when you share someone's address, you know, like there's always 1% crazies out there and it's just like people stalking Elon, you know, and the incident that happened outside an airport with his kid, you know, people will take advantage of that. People want their 1 minute of fame. They want to know if they're real, these people, you know, so they'll try themselves, and that's dangerous. And then I think AI is potentially going to scale that. Is that a valid argument that AI is going to drastically scale pretty much everything? Like, let's say that I want to organize a coup against someone that I don't like. And, you know, yeah. I just hired this AI anti-PR agency. Would it be feasible to think that, you know, all these articles would pop up against this person and I would just demolish them and their career? Would that be a thing of the future?
Well, I think that if you want to harass somebody, there are cases of people being harassed right now, right? That's been going on for a long time. I mean, even pre-internet. I think that the internet's made it easier to do it and do it anonymously. We've seen a lot of the brigading that happens in like 4chan and things like that. And I think there's a lot of, example, I mean, using the 4chan example, right? Like there are a lot of trans activists that like they've gone after and things like that. Right. And I think that like, you know, I think one of the things that we maybe need to take more seriously on the internet is legally is threats, right? Because people make threats and they think that they'll never be tracked down. And most of the time they aren't. But I think if we make the penalties higher, people will be less reluctant to do it. I think there's a whole like revenge porn law, which we've done where for non-consensual, nudes and things like that. I think that was a step in the right direction, right? Giving people a little more agency over control of their, you know, their body, right? And their something that's really private to them. But I think the question around AI is going to be, you know, if you think about the places where, articles surface and things get distributed, I think the question is, you know, as the amount of content starts to scale, how do the algorithms, you know, Meta's, Google's, Twitter's or X's or whatever, you know, how do they start to respond to that stuff? And I don't have a good answer. I hesitate to give a definitive answer about where that goes, in part because like there's implications for work at Meta, right? But also I think that like, you know, I think the question that we aren't doing a good job of handling right now is, what happens to content in general when there is, 100 times more than we have right now and 99.9% of it is AI garbage, right? I think that like the estimate I saw a few years ago is about like 50% of content on the web was algorithmically generated garbage. Sure it's higher.
SEO is crap. If you do a Google search in regards of your health, you know, it would be Healthline and all these bullshit websites.
Yeah.
Not to insult anyone because I think Healthline was started by a guy on the West Coast. But I mean, it's you know, you hire people from the Philippines and you give them, you know, really basic knowledge that's not even scientifically proven. I think that's toxic.
Yeah. No, I say it gets dangerous. And I think that like this is something that, that we have to wrestle with. I think that like, if a motivated individual can make your life miserable. I think that's really scary, and I know people like that. I'm sure you know people like that where like one person just like, got like, I think there was a great story about, I wish I could find it, but it was like a woman was, I think I was heard on a podcast, like a woman was like, her reputation, she was like a realtor and her reputation was being damaged online, negative reviews, all this stuff. Really terrible things. And it turns out it had been like some random person was offended by like an offhand comment like 10 years earlier, and just couldn't let it go. And I think that like, I think that AI maybe makes the problem worse, but at the end of the day, the problem is us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's the thing. And well, it's like the good old saying, you don't want to start a war like with pretty much anyone, right? Because it becomes lose-lose and a war is won by the person that has the most time and energy in their hands, and
that's absolutely
just
true.
They just need to be a bit crooked mentally and then they will invest pretty much half of their day to try to destroy you. So that's kind of dangerous. And while I was listening to you speak, you were mentioning that some people make threats online. Before we have AIs trying to detect that, wouldn't be wise for the government just to have a bounty program, like identify that person and get $100 per person that we catch doing that or something?
Yeah, I hadn't thought about a bounty program. That'd be interesting to consider because it would motivate people to track things down. I think part of it is, I think a lot of the times that you're going to need subpoena power to be able to like go to the ISPs and track people down and stuff like that, which is hard.
Especially like crowdsourcing, you give the power to the crowds. Maybe some of them would actually come up AIs and stuff.
Yeah, that's possible. I hadn't really thought about it. But I do think that, like, you know, it's just frustrating that, you know, people like, and just people doing their jobs, whether public or private officials, like, you know, you see these like government officials, you know, judges and things like that now getting death threats. You see people like, look, here's what I'll say. You can disagree with people, but you can't ever threaten somebody like that. Cause you know, the psychological damage that you do, I mean, you know, I think we really underestimate that. Like once you start like, you know, and you can find lots of examples all over the world, right? But of people who've been like, you know, they start getting death threats and people saying, and then people start sending like pictures of their house, you know, and stuff like that. And that's why like my address being shared, you know, when Valley Wag shared it, like it really like, you know, bothered me because it's like, I, you know, people could show up in my house, you know?
Right. And that's why I'm renting. Elon was renting too. I guess that was one of the main reasons too, but yeah, it's creepy. And nowadays it's easier than ever to neutralize someone. That's another fact, you know? So it's not just being paranoid, is that if you have the intel, you share that online, then someone can decide to do that, you know? And yeah, that's incredibly toxic for society and its growth.
I think that there are things that are in the public interest, right? Sure. You know, I could imagine that there is a circumstance in which publishing a home address would be in the public interest. I'm sure it's happened and it's been like justifiable, but you know, in general, I think that we should err on the side of you know, trying to give people some sense of security, right? But I also think that like I said, people are so oddly casual about sending a death threat. I got death threats when I was doing Engadget, which was like blew my mind because I'm like, dude, I write about iPods, like, you know what I mean? Like, there's like you know what I'm saying? It's like I write about iPods and laptops. It's like, how angry could you get about something I said? And I remember one really clear where it was like the guy was like, "I'm gonna behead you. I'm like, I'm gonna get your head chopped off." You know, and I was just like you, on one hand, you're like, I don't want to take it seriously. But on the other hand, you're just like, man, somebody out there is that level of angry at me.
But does it surprise you in today's society? It's so easy to be some kind of sour loser, you know, like it's easy. I mean, me, I've worked tons on my self-development, my psyche, and everything that pertains to my mental sanity. You probably did too. But it's sort of easy to think that I could have ended up one of these losers. You know, I was addicted to World of Warcraft at some point. Then it was alcohol. So I got out of that, fortunately, because I had probably like a great circle around me, great family and so forth. But it's sort of easy to fall onto that. And then you look at social media, there's hate and anger everywhere. And then these people don't take care of their health and their body. Their whole biological state is messed up, you know, and you get anger, you know? So does it surprise you?
Yeah. But you know, the thing is like, we've created a society, and I actually don't even think social media is at core the problem. And I'm not just saying that because I work at Meta. I think at the core is that like, we think about the kinds of, you know, like cities and environments that people grow up in now. And we're very isolated. I was lucky enough. I spent 3 years living in Europe when I was younger, and not that Europe is like perfect or whatever, but like, you know, having like walkable, you know, areas, denser areas. I think like we're people that need other people, whether we think that or not. Right. And we're not meant to be. We need nature. We need people, right? Like we need all of it. And I think we need to be, you know, one of the things I worry about for myself is that like, as I get older, you know, should I move back to Manhattan? Because like, I'll just be in a denser, closer, you know, place, right? You know, don't able to be that. Around more people. And sorry, what, Ryan?
Don't do that. Well, the other day I was researching what cities are most likely to get nuked, and New York came up first.
Yeah, of course, because it's a big city, yeah. but you know what I'm saying? It's like, I think that like we, you know, it's why, have you seen this project to like, to create a, build a new city in the Bay Area?
Yeah, it was pretty fascinating.
Yeah. Now, what I love about it is the guy who's behind it, he's from Czechia, Czech Republic, right? And he wants to, you know, design things so that people don't need cars, so that people are in like, you know, have a chance to like be around other people, like get outside, you know, go to the cafe. And I think that like we've built a society, especially here in the US, right, where people are more isolated and it's not their fault. You know, like if you can't walk around and bump into other people, like you're just going to be a more lonely person. Like that's just reality. Like a lot of people, you know, I was lucky enough to go to like a regular 4-year college and live on campus and, you know, all that stuff. And a lot of people look back at that time as like the best time of their life. And the reason why is because where they live and where they work, where they study, right, and where they eat and all that stuff, it's all there. And all the people that they want to know and hang out with, they're all there too. And they're all just running into each other all day. And you feel connected and you're part of a community, even if you're still, you know, you're still yourself, an individual, but like you're part of this broader community and you're connected and you have the support system. And I think that that is, I think, you know, there are people, you know, that are able to like, you know, develop like yourself, like develop that support system and, you know, like overcome those obstacles. But, you know how difficult that was, right? And how much of an accomplishment that is. And for most people, like they don't have the structure of their lives to be able to do that.
Yeah. I have my wife nowadays and 4 dogs, but you know, I'm a pretty somewhat solitary individual. Maybe from my WoW days, you know, I've learned that I could spend like 10 hours in front of a computer and without needing much social interactions, but that's so important. You know, fortunately I go out every day and go to the gym and so forth, but yeah, there's meetups that have tried to brought people closer. There's been Evan Bright. How could we use technology to bring people closer? There's been Tinder, obviously. There's been Bumble. Bumble is quite cool, actually. So is there a technological solution to that?
You know, like I said, I'm not sure it's a technological solution, because I think in a way, like we have the things that will bring people together virtually as much as we can, right? Whether that's social media platforms or metaverse type stuff or games or whatever. I think those are great. Like I play games with my friends, you know, a few times a week, and it's, we're all over the country and, you know, it's great. We get to come together and we talk and all that stuff. Right. That wouldn't happen normally. And we don't live in a place where we could all just get together like a cafe or something after work. Right. But I think that like I said, I think it's why, you know, I like this idea of building a new city, because I think that we actually need to have different cities, right, at the end of the day. And that's going to take a long time. But, you know, that's kind of what we have. Like what we need is like, we need to have like my dream, honestly, would be able to like, you know, have like a, maybe like a neighborhood where I had like, you know, a co-working space that was maybe a 5-minute walk from me, and then like shops, and I'm maybe like 10 minutes from shops and restaurants and stuff like that. You know, 5 to 10 minutes, but like, I would love to have like, you know, but also to have all, but more people that like I knew, you know, within range. And one thing somebody asked me was like, you know, you're older, you know, and you're like, great, I'm older, but like, you know, what's your advice, right? Like, what would you do differently? And I said, you know, it's not a work thing that I would do differently. I would say, if you can make it happen, try to be within a 5 to 10 minute walk of people that you love. If you can do that, yeah, it will change your life. And I, you know, and I don't have enough of that, you know, in my life right now. I had a lot of it in New York, because New York is so dense, and I lived in Manhattan, and, you know, like you walk 10 minutes and you're like halfway across, you know, the island or whatever. But that's something that like, I would tell young people is, you know, think about that, like where you live, you know, is important, especially as we go to have more remote work, where you live becomes more important in a way. Because, you know, the people that you really care about that are going to be in your life for a long time, 10, 20, 30 years, not usually people you work with sometimes, but, you know, having those people close to you and within like the ability to like, just not have to get in a car to go see them.
Yeah. Walking is so good for the body, the chemistry. Einstein got all of his ideas walking, and so many other folks, Steve Jobs.
Exactly.
Travis Cal Canning.
Yeah, that was Steve Jobs' thing, is he would always go for a walk. And I think they designed the new Apple campus so that you could do a loop in the time for me.
Travis Kalanick was always walking in a circle in the Uber headquarters. And I'm actually thinking of that too. How could I not, you know, here in Oaxaca, very near the mountain here, you just go up and there's a mountain for sale. So I'd love to create my own little community, but then my brain is like, I need to have the bots that will create houses for $1,000 each, you know, I call it the $1,000 house. But I have so much on my list. Peter, thanks for today. We should do that every year. I'm going to rebook another call in 12 months from now. Where can people find out more about you?
You know, it's funny. I'm on Threads now, not Twitter so much. PF Rojas, PF.Rojas. I'm on Threads. I have to remember because I don't have my usual username there. Or just roj.as is my website, and people can reach me there. I'm easy to I answer everybody who contacts me.